Good afternoon. In the ICUs of University Hospital, not far from here, we take care of the sickest of the sick patients. It's a great privilege. It's a responsibility. It has incredible lows and has incredible highs. Let me tell you about two of our patients. If this works, I'm going to show you the picture of a spunky little six-year-old who on February 4th was a happy, healthy kid doing fine. On February 5th got the flu. On February 6th, she's dying of influenza and pneumonitis, a common problem. Some of you are going to die of influenza and pneumonitis. She's in septic shock someday. Not today. And if you do, if you get it, we'll take care of you. We're real good at it. This little girl, in fact, she was in Missouri. But she, the doctors there had done everything they could do. She's on maximal settings on the ventilator. They can't do any more. They tell her mom she's probably going to die. The mortality, when you get to this stage, is very, very high, whether it's a child or an adult. Imagine if we had an artificial lung that we could plug in this kid to that would prolong her life long enough so that we could make a diagnosis and treat the problem. Well, we do. You heard a little bit about this. This is the ECMO machine. Doesn't look like a lung, but in fact, it's an artificial lung and an artificial heart. And extracorporeal means it's outside the body. You have to run the blood through it. And what this refers to, this technology, is replacing heart and lung function with mechanical devices outside the body. Let me hook her up to this apparatus. Can you still hear me? Okay. I think this will work. I'll talk into it. So you can see here that 2 days into it, this big tube on the right side of her neck, that's going into her heart. That's draining blood out and putting it back, all of her blood, every minute. And you don't have to be a radiologist to realize that white is bad, black is good. When it comes to chest x-rays, this is not so good. 10 days later, she's back here in Ann Arbor. Her lungs still don't work at all. She's hooked up to the ECMO machine. It's keeping her alive. A month later, her lungs don't work at all. We're beginning to think this is futile. We should probably stop. A few years ago, we would have quit. But we've learned from experience that perseverance is valuable. And a week later, her lungs start to open up. A week after that, she's off the ECMO system. A week after that, just last 2 weeks ago, she's ready to go home. Here's another patient, a man named Tom. He's 55 years old. He's here visiting in Ann Arbor. He has a massive heart attack. He comes into our emergency room, has a cardiac arrest. People there are good at what they do. The chance of him surviving is about 7% with CPR. Imagine if we had artificial heart that we could plug into him for a day, an hour, a week, however long it took to figure out what caused his heart attack and to treat it. Well, in fact, we do. That's what the ECMO machine is. We have lots of artificial hearts, in fact, because it's pretty easy just pumping blood around, but only one that we can deploy in a couple of minutes. That's the ECMO machine. So here he is 3 days later. His heart's not beating at all. He's alert and awake. He's talking to his wife. He's supported by this device, and we can see that he's not making any headway. He's going to need a heart transplant. So we implant an implantable artificial heart called a VAD, and he can then go home waiting for a donor for his heart. This particular patient recovered, and we took the VAD out. So we're talking about this technology, extracorporeal life support, which, as I've said, refers to supportive heart or lung function with mechanical devices, which is temporary, days to maybe weeks, can be partial or total support, avoids ongoing iatrogenic injury. Iatrogenic means caused by doctors. We can take him off the ventilator and the high pressure. We can take him off the oxygen. we can take him off all those drugs that are used to support his heart but are intrinsically toxic. And it just sustains life while we can figure out what the problem is and fix it. Now, here's a diagram of the system. That machine I showed you, in fact, this is all there is to it. We put a big tube in the heart, we drain blood out, we pump it through an artificial lung, often a membrane lung, and we pump it back into the patient, and it will take over the function of the heart and lung for a significant period of time. This forum is about great, exciting new ideas. This is a great idea, but in no way is it new. This is a heart-lung machine, first used in the 50s for heart surgery. Then in the 60s, we and other people got working on making membrane type of lungs, which are safer and can be used for a longer period of time. And in the 70s, we treated the first newborn case, 1975, in fact, this little girl. And what do you know? She recovered and got better. Well, then we treated another one and another one. And after a while, we got to learn from our successes. We learned a lot more from the failures. And this technology started to grow in the area of newborn respiratory failure. We thought we ought to publish this work. None of the pediatric journals would publish it. My God, do you know there's a surgeon out there who's hooking babies to this machine? Oh, my God, don't publish it. Other people might try to do it. But, but in fact, neonatologists who were losing babies came to learn this technique from us, and we more and more centers started up with this. And soon there were centers in academic centers around the country and, in fact, around the world who learned how to do this, and they did the same thing at home. Now there are about 50,000 patients who've been managed this way, not always successful, but about two-thirds of them go home healthy and have long, healthy lives. Someone earlier was talking about saving lives. We never save lives, we only prolong them. But if you can prolong the life of the baby for 70 years, that's worth doing. There are now about 200 ECMO centers around the world. You can see where they are. We share ideas and communicate with each other through an organization called the Extracorporeal Life Support Organization, or ELSO. It's based here in Ann Arbor. Now, you notice there are several centers in Australia and New Zealand. You might remember that swine flu epidemic that ran around the world in 2009. It started in the Southern Hemisphere. All right? All right. I can start again. Yeah. I'm just pointing out that the Australians are very good about keeping data in their healthcare system. So in that summer of 2009, which is our winter of 2009, they preceded our winter. It was their winter, our summer. They had 200 patients who were thought to be dying of this flu epidemic. You might remember all the press that went on. Actually, most of those patients got better with just good care in an ICU, but 68 of them were failing, looking like the little girl that I mentioned to you earlier. 75% of those patients walked out of the hospital. Pretty good for a fatal disease, and they published this very early so that those of us in the Northern Hemisphere learned from that, planned about how many patients we might expect to have, and in fact did pretty well with that particular epidemic. Now, medical research of the type I've been telling you about has been going on for centuries. If you're dealing with breast cancer or cleft palate or leprosy or diabetes or chronic kidney failure or acute heart and lung failure, someone imagines that we could treat that problem better than we do now. They take that idea to the laboratory, they work on it there until they have some sort of solution, try it out in animals. If that works, take it on to patients. That's called clinical research, back to the lab, back to the patients, and finally may solve the actual problem that they started with. The NIH, about 10 years ago, invented a name for this type of research, translational research. We love that. It's the buzzword in grants these days. And it's practical, goal-oriented. Here's a problem. Let's see if we can solve it in a few years. To be differentiated from mechanistic research, I wonder why fruit fly genes make fruit flies this or that, things like that. Wonderful stuff, but not going to apply clinically in a few years of time. So I'm really here to tell you about three new ideas that fall in the headline of translational research that spin off from the ECMO project. The implantable lung has completed that cycle. It's now gone to clinical practice. The artificial placenta is still in the lab phase, mulling down there. Eventually, we'll get to clinical trials. The organ bank, which is the most exciting idea, is still in the idea phase. So here's the problem. Patients who need a lung transplant with end-stage chronic lung disease, if they have an exacerbation, now they're admitted to the hospital, admitted to RICU, they come off the list. They're going to get pneumonia, they're going to get cachexia, ECMO can help a little bit, but not much, and they all die. Imagine if we had an implantable artificial lung that would work for months at a time, the time it takes to get a donor for a lung. And if we had such an apparatus, then patients could get up and out of bed, out of the ICU, exercise, and get to be in good shape to receive a lung transplant. We've been working on this for about 15 years. In our lab and a couple of labs in Japan and in Germany have focused on this, and we've learned the physiology, and we've built artificial lungs that can be perfused by the right ventricle and look like they could solve this problem. The first clinical trial was in Regensberg, Germany. This young lady has end-stage cystic fibrosis. She was admitted to the ICU, taken off the list, but then this device, which you see being held in the hand of the attendant, is attached to her pulmonary artery and her left atrium, and her right ventricle is pumping blood through this device. Did that for 5 weeks of time. A donor came up at this, when this picture's taken, she's on her way to Munich to get her lung transplant, which worked. This has now been done about 60 times around the world, so we're quite pleased with that. We've completed that cycle. What we thought might work is working quite well. We've done several of those patients here in Ann Arbor. Here's another problem, premature birth. The biggest problem in obstetrics and all of neonatology, about 500,000 babies are born just in the United States every year, prematurely. If they're not too premature, the results are quite good, but the younger they are, the smaller they are, the worse the results, and 50 to 100,000 of those babies die or are permanently disabled every year. Imagine if we could maintain the fetal conditions of circulation and lung function while the lungs grew and then eventually unhook the baby from that system. We call it an artificial placenta. Now, we've been at this for about 5 years, and what we have learned is that using the ECMO system, we can maintain the fetal circulation. That means no blood goes to the lungs, baby doesn't need to breathe, and in fact, we manage these fetal lambs in artificial amniotic fluid. This little lamb is underwater, breathing, but breathing amniotic fluid, which normal fetuses do. We can now do this for about 3 days. When we can do it for a couple weeks, we'll take it to the clinic. Here's another problem. Organs which we take for transplantation in brain-dead donors live for only 6 to 24 hours. 6 hours for hearts, livers, lungs, 24 hours for kidneys. After that, we can't transplant them. We have tissue culture. We can grow cells. We've been able to do that for a long time. We can put those cells in scaffolds and call it an artificial kidney, but it's really not, just tissue culture. No one has ever been able to take an intact, vascularized organ and perfuse it for hours, days, weeks at a time to keep it alive. Why is that? Well, we think we can figure that out. Then you can imagine an unlimited supply of hearts, lungs, livers, kidneys, bone marrow, endocrine organs for elective transplantation. Not only that, perfectly matched organs for transplantation. We could give gene therapy to the lung or liver and put it back in the patient. Gene therapy now is too toxic to give to the whole patient. We could treat cancer and infection on the bench, and we could do all this research on human organs, not animals. So we think about this. We can keep patients alive for a long time, as I showed you. Could we keep organs alive for months of time? Well, our laboratory is applying the ECMO technology to answer that question. We're very good at perfusion. We've assembled experts in perfusate, what stuff to use to perfuse organs. We've assembled experts who know about resuscitating damaged organs back to life. And so I hope to come back here in 5 years and tell you that we have solved this problem. And up on the North Campus, there's a warehouse full of hearts, lungs, livers, kidneys. Come pick one that matches. I thank you for your attention.